And then, of course, I would be very remiss if I didn't mention Katrina Macht, Mrs. Macht, because we... because she started this concern for the environment long before she'd ever heard, well, she may have heard of me, but she hadn't heard of Roots and Shoots. And we've been writing back and forth since 1993. And I would be very remiss if I didn't mention my wonderful family, because they've been so supportive all along. And not only did my mother have the sensitivity to see the excitement when I saw a hen lay an egg, but there were so many other little incidents while I was growing up as a child where she gave me this support. And when I began dreaming of Africa, I was 11 years old, 10 or 11, and I began to read the books about Tarzan, Lord of the Jungle, and I fell madly in love with him. Not from Johnny Weissmuller, we didn't have television in those days, but my picture of Tarzan. And you know, he's got that wife, Jane. I was so jealous of Jane. And I thought she was a wimp. And I thought I would have been a better mate for Tarzan myself. Which I would have, right? Don't you think so? Yeah. So she helped me find these books that I wanted to read. And when I had this dream of going to Africa, living with animals and writing books about them, everybody laughed. I mean, this is going back into the Second World War. Africa was still the dark continent. We didn't know very much about Africa. And there weren't 747s going out with tourists. There were just a few white hunters and government officials and missionaries that went out. And we didn't have any money. And so how would I get to Africa? Above all, I was a girl. I mean, it was a ridiculous dream. So people would say, Jane, get real. You know, only that's modern slang. We didn't say get real in those days, but whatever the equivalent was. Except for my mother. And she used to say, Jane, if you really want something, and if you work hard, and if you take advantage of opportunity, and if you never give up, if you never give up, you find a way. And you may not go directly to your goal. Now, the direct way for me to have got to Africa and Gombe and the chimpanzees would be to leave school, to go to university, to get my degrees, to get a grant, and then to find a place to go and study them. But that didn't happen for a whole variety of reasons. And we couldn't afford the university fees. And so Mum said, well, do a secretarial training, and then you can get a job anywhere in the world. And that's what I did. And then came the opportunity, because I never lost the dream. And I was working in London, but I went to the Natural History Museum almost every lunchtime. And I went on learning about animals in Africa and reading books. And when the opportunity came, it was a letter from a school friend. And her parents had moved to Kenya. Would I go there for a holiday? Well, wow, that was opportunity. But still, there wasn't any money, because London was expensive. So I went home and I worked as a waitress and I saved up the wages and I saved up the tips until finally I had enough for a return fare to Africa. So that was when I sailed off at 23 and said, you know, goodbye to my family, my friends and my country. And what an amazing adventure, because it hasn't ended yet. And when I met Lewis Leakey, I heard that this man could tell me and help me to do something with animals. And when I went to the Natural History Museum, of which he was curator, he asked me all kinds of questions. And it was because I could answer many of those questions. In other words, I was ready for this opportunity. And the opportunity was an invitation to try and learn about the chimpanzees of Gombe. Well, I was ready. Other people were not. It was very hard. It took him a year to find money because I was a girl, because I didn't have a degree, because I was straight from England. So during that year, after I'd worked for him for a year at the museum, then I went back to England and I learned everything I could about chimpanzees, and it wasn't much known then. And he was trying to get money and he wouldn't give up. And finally, a wealthy American businessman said, all right, here's money for 6 months. We'll see what this young woman can do. But then there was a second problem. What's Tanzania today, which is where the Gombe National Park is, was then Tanganyika. It was a British protectorate. And the authorities said, a girl on her own in the bush, studying wild chimpanzees. This is absolutely insane. But he wouldn't give up. So in the end, they said, all right, but she must have a companion. And that was when that same amazing mother volunteered to come for 4 months. And she was not only an amazing companion with whom to share the early frustrations and excitements. And when I say frustrations, the biggest frustration was that the chimpanzees had never seen anything like me before, and they were terrified. They're very conservative, these chimpanzees. And even if I was as far away as probably twice the length of this gymnasium, they would just disappear into the forest. And the biggest worry was that I wouldn't see anything really exciting before the money ran out, because then I knew that that would be it. And everyone would have said, well, we told you so, and I would be letting Lewis Leakey down, and my dream would come to an end. So it was lovely to have my mother there, and I could get back at the end of a day. And she was always on the positive side, like, well, what have you seen? Well, how exciting, you saw chimpanzees building a nest. And how wonderful, you saw two chimpanzees greeting each other with an embrace. And even if it was far away, she was there, and she built up the excitement. She helped me to keep my faith. And also, she could share she set up a little clinic. It was very simple medications like aspirins and Band-Aids and things that probably few of you here know about, but which we do in Africa, which is a saline drip that you pour on wounds, 1 teaspoon of salt and warm water. And she spent hours on some of the fishermen who came to her. And because she cared about people, she made some amazing cures. In fact, she was known as a white witch doctor, I think because she practiced white magic rather than black magic. And she therefore established for me a wonderful relationship with all the local people, and that stood me in good stead ever since. So by the time she left, I was kind of accepted by the authorities. They thought I was a bit crazy, but that I was okay. So that was how it all began. And I was there in the first place because Lewis Leakey believed that learning something about our closest living relatives, living in their natural environment, might help him as he tried to imagine how the early Stone Age men and women, whose fossils he was finding, how did they live, how did they behave? And if we read books today about prehistory, we almost always see that the chimpanzees, and particularly the chimpanzees of Gombe, will be talked about. And people now think about the behavior of early humans in relation to the behavior of the wild great apes. Lewis Leakey didn't realize how like us chimpanzees are, because so much has been found out since he sent me. First of all, he had no idea, because nobody had any idea, that chimpanzees and humans in the structure of our DNA differ by only just over 1%, which is extraordinary, but it happens to be true. And he didn't realize the extent to which we realize today how like us they are in the structure of their blood. So you could get a blood transfusion from a chimpanzee, but not from a gorilla, if you match the blood group. And their immune system is like ours, and that's why they can be infected with all known human contagious diseases. And that's why so many thousands of them are kept in 5-foot by 5-foot cages by themselves, sometimes for the 40 or 50 years that they can live. The brain is more like ours than that of any other living creature, the chimpanzee and the other great apes. And so it shouldn't surprise us to find that when you study them, they show a lot of social behavior, which is very much like ours, that they have minds capable of rational thought and simple problem solving, that they have emotions similar to, maybe identical, with happiness, sadness, fear, despair, and so on. They have a sense of humor. They have a self-identity. And we don't have time to go into the whys and wherefores of all this, but it's all been written about, and what I'm telling you has been shown again and again and again. So, a couple of stories here. First of all, there was one old female at Gombe that we knew very well, and she suffered in an epidemic of polio. It was brought into the chimps from the surrounding people, and she lost the use of one arm. And she often traveled about with her daughter, Little B. Her name was Madame B. And when she lost the use of one arm, and as she got older, she sometimes found it very exhausting to travel a long distance from one food source to the next. And so when she would arrive, her daughter, Little B, would run up the tree and start feeding with those happy sounds that the chimps make when they find good food. But Madame B would just lie on the ground and gaze up. And on a number of different occasions, Little B would eat for about 10 minutes, and then she'd stuff fruits into her mouth, and chimps have these big lips, and she'd take fruit in one hand, climb down, and lay the fruit from her hand beside her mother, and they would sit feeding together. The bonds between chimpanzee family members are very strong, very affectionate, very enduring, and they may last right through the lifespan of the individuals concerned. An example, a vivid example of that, is that an adult male named Satan. It was named Satan because in the very early days, my mother was writing a book and he stole the manuscript. And we had to exchange it for a banana. And by now, he's in this story, he's 25 years old, he's in his prime, he's a big, strong male. And well, I thought it was going to be another fire alarm. We had a fire alarm this morning. And so anyway, Satan comes along a forest trail, and there's a nice fruit tree with some chimps feeding, and he goes up, and he spies a really nice ripe bunch of fruit, and there's a younger male feeding there. So Satan goes swaggering up the way chimps do and threats the younger male away from this bunch of fruit. But what Satan didn't realize is that higher up in the tree is that young male's brother. And so as the young male starts to scream, the brother comes swinging down with his hair bristling, and the two brothers set upon Satan. That's the way dominance works. You need allies. And so now Satan begins to scream. To our amazement, his very ancient mother, some of you have read about Flo. Well, this old female sprout was about the same age as Flo before she died. I mean, really skinny and shriveled, and her hair was all sparse. And she's feeding two trees away, and hearing her great, big, strong son screaming, she goes swinging furiously like an avenging angel across the distance between the trees, and she drops down, and she hurls her puny self on these three big, struggling males and starts hitting them. And I think they were so surprised that they stopped attacking Satan, and they kind of gave a few little hits at her, and Satan was able to get out of the way. So these are the kind of stories that really help us to understand how like us chimpanzees are. And there was another where a little orphan of 3 1/2 lost his mother. And he should have been still suckling, riding on her back and sleeping with her at night until he was 5 or even 6 when the next baby is born. And when a mother dies and leaves an orphaned infant, if that child is less than 3, he or she will die because they're really dependent on milk till they're 3. And Mel was just beginning to depend on solid foods, but he didn't have any other family members. If he'd had an older sister, or if he'd had an older brother, he would have been adopted. We've seen it time and again. But Mel was on his own in the world, and we expected him to die. But in fact, he was adopted by a 12-year-old adolescent male, not related to the family at all, Spindle. And Spindle now waited for Mel, carried him on his back, shared his food with him, let him climb into his sleeping nest at night, even rescued him when he got too close to the adult males when they were challenging one another, and in that state may actually pick up and hurl an infant who gets in the way. Spindle took on Mel's mother's role and rescued him in that situation too, and definitely saved Mel's life. Now, we don't know why an adolescent male would risk so much in a way, because he's now hampered by this little infant clinging to his back, rather like a mother is. But he's a young male just beginning to feel his oats, just beginning to start moving out into the adult world. So why did he do this? Why did he rescue little Mel, who's sickly and not related? Well, maybe we'll never know, But during the epidemic, when Mel's mother died, it was some kind of pneumonia, Spindle lost his ancient mother. And that's the same sprout as ran to help Satan, Spindle's older brother. And when you're 12 years old, you don't need your mother, you're perfectly independent. But if she's alive, you spend a lot of time with her. And especially if you get wounded or you get into some kind of conflict with the big males and perhaps lose your confidence, if your mother's alive, you will go back and spend time with her. And maybe losing his mother left an empty space in Spindle's heart, which was to some extent filled by this close contact with a small dependent infant. And I lost my best friend 2 years ago, my own mother. And so I can really sympathize with Spindle, because it does leave an empty space in your life which can never really be filled. But anyway, for whatever reason, Spindle saved Mel's life, and that's an example of real, true altruism. So here we find these extraordinary beings living out in the forest who do perhaps more than any other living creature to help us understand that there isn't a sharp line dividing humans from the rest of the animal kingdom. It's a very blurry line, and it's getting more blurry all the time. So many things we used to think unique to ourselves, we find that the chimpanzees are doing as well. It was the same with tool using. When I was growing up at school, we humans were defined as man the tool maker. We were supposed to be the only beings on this planet who could use and make tools. That was supposed to distinguish us more than anything else from all the other animals. And then, as many of you know, one day I observed David Greybeard picking pieces of grass and using them as tools. And he would even pick leafy twigs and strip away the leaves. That's the beginning of tool making, to make a probe to fish for termites. And there are many other ways that chimpanzees use objects as tools. And if we look across Africa, which is where chimps live, every single population that's been studied has its own tool-using behaviors. And they're learned by the young ones who watch the adults. And so the behavior is passed from one generation to the next through observation and learning. And that is a definition of culture. That's something else that we used to think unique to ourselves. And chimpanzees in captivity can be taught American Sign Language, and they can learn more than 300 signs. Gorillas can learn that language as well. And chimpanzees can learn other human types of languages. And they have mental ability that enables them to solve simple problems and make plans for the immediate future. And they have wonderful memories and many other intellectual abilities that we used to think unique to us. And so this all teaches us a new respect, not only for the chimpanzees, but for the other amazing animals with whom we share the planet. Because after all, we are not the only beings who have personalities. You know that from your dogs, your cats, and so forth. But science wasn't prepared to accept it when I went to Gombe. Humans are not the only beings with personalities. And we're not the only beings with minds capable of rational thought. And above all, we're not the only beings with emotions, with feelings, capable of feeling happiness, sadness, fear, despair, and so forth. And so this raises a whole lot of ethical problems when we think about ways that we use and abuse so many animals in our daily lives. Once we dare to admit that we're not the only beings with personalities, minds, and feelings. And now imagine we've got this sharp line, which isn't really a sharp line at all, and a chimpanzee approaches us, and he reaches across this line, and he looks into our eyes, and he says, well, don't we matter too? Aren't you prepared to accept that we feel in so many ways like you do? And if you dare look into those eyes and take that hand, then what will the chimpanzee do? He'll turn around and say, and what about all these others? Don't they matter as well? So this, in a way, the chimpanzee is the best ambassador from the animal kingdom to us. The chimpanzee's eyes can plead for better treatment for them and for other animals as well. So how sad to find that in the wild the chimpanzees are absolutely disappearing. From 2 million 100 years ago down to 250,000 at the most is what we think of chimpanzees living today, and it could be much less. And it's going on all the time, even at Gombe. When I arrived there in 1960, you could travel along Lake Tanganyika, which is about 300 miles long, and you would see forests, chimpanzee habitats coming down from the steep hills to the lake, almost unbroken, a little town here, a small village there. And you could climb up those hills and look out to the east, away from the lake, chimpanzee habitat as far as you could see. If you go back today, you find that the national park, the Gombe National Park, is the same as it always was, but it's only 30 square miles. It's tiny. And outside the park, to the north, to the south, and to the east, the trees have gone. Not some trees, basically all the trees. And the only ones left are in the really steep ravines where people can't cut them down. And it's happened because the human population there has grown, as it has everywhere, but also because refugees have been pouring into this area from Burundi and from over the lake from Congo. And as the trees go, so there's terrible soil erosion and the soil loses its fertility. And when I flew over that, the whole park 10 years ago with a film team and saw the sharp edge to the park and how desert-like it was beyond, I had a real shock. I knew it was bad, but I didn't know it was that bad, and I didn't know that the loss of trees was so extensive. And so the question came, how can we even think of saving these very famous, very precious chimpanzees, Fifi and Gremlin and the twins Golden and Glitter and the descendants of David Greybeard and Goliath and Mike? How can we even try to save them if the people are beginning to have a difficulty in surviving? And that led to a program, a Jane Goodall Institute program, which is one I'm proudest of, called Takari, initially funded by the European Union, but now it's got bigger. We have funding from other sources. And basically what it's doing is to improve the lives of the villagers living around Gombe and up and down the lakeshore. So we have this program in 33 villages. It's tree nurseries, it's ways of preventing soil erosion, controlling soil erosion, the best farming methods for the really steep and difficult country. It's working with groups of women to give them some way of earning money, some small environmentally sustainable development programs, providing primary health care, raising money for scholarships so that some of the girls can go from primary school to secondary school, because in this part of Tanzania it's so poor that they mostly can't afford to do that. And we also provide family planning and AIDS education. And there's roots and shoots in every one of those 33 villages. And so now the people are happy that we're there. They understand that we realize that they're part of the environment. We've been told it's the best program of its kind in Africa, and we're ready to replicate it now in other places. But that's a drop in the bucket. Go across the rest of Africa, you find the forests and the woodlands disappearing, as well as all the wilderness areas being encroached upon by ever-growing human populations. And these are people who are so poor that even though they know that cutting down the trees is going to make a desert, it'll be a desert in 5 years or 10 years, are they stupid? No, they're not stupid, but they've got to feed themselves and their families today. And it's only when you've met poverty like that that you understand they are caught in a trap. There's nothing they can do except go on cutting down the forest to try and grow food to feed themselves. And so as we lay waste the forest, so the desert is spreading. And as the desert spreads and the soil erosion gets worse and the land gets less fertile, so the poverty increases and the droughts get worse and the flooding gets worse. And then in addition to this suffering of people and animals alike, we find that where the last stronghold for the chimps was in Central Africa in the Great Congo Basin, there they're disappearing along with every other animal living there because of what's known as the bushmeat trade. and that's the commercial hunting of wild animals for food. It isn't like the hunters in a village who want to eat and go out to catch some animals to feed their families. This is hunters going deep into the heart of the forest where they never could before and shooting everything, elephants, gorillas, chimpanzees, monkeys, down to birds and bats, and smoking the meat or drying it in the sun and taking it into the towns where people pay more for it because it's their culture to prefer the meat of wild animals. So how's this all possible? It's possible because the logging companies have made roads deep into the heart of the forest. And even though mostly they're practicing sustainable logging, they're leaving a forest with most of its trees intact and only taking out the biggest. The forest will have no animals left. And there's another problem here, and that is that the logging camps are big because they give quite good conditions, so it's the staff and their families, and there may be 2,000 people living in the heart of the forest where nobody was before, except the pygmies, the indigenous people, and other people moving in along the sides of the roads because it's transport for the first time. And these people, these 2,000 or 3,000 extra people, want to eat. And so the pygmies are being given money and guns to go and shoot animals for the logging camps. And that's not sustainable either. So when the logging camp moves on, it may leave standing trees, but there will be almost no animals. And the indigenous people who've lived in harmony with the forest for hundreds and hundreds of years will be left devastated. So this problem is a very difficult one, and I won't go now into what we're doing to try and halt or at least slow down the bushmeat trade, particularly in the great apes and other endangered species. But if anyone's interested, there's something about the Congo Basin Project on our website, which is janegoodall.org. And so these are the kind of things we're involved in Africa. And because of the bushmeat trade, mother chimps are shot, but baby chimps, well, there's not much flesh on a little baby chimp. So they're being sold in the marketplaces. They're being kept as pets in the villages, but nobody knows how to treat them, and they mostly die. And we've persuaded the governments in some of these countries to confiscate them, and then we have to look after them. So we have our sanctuary programs, where our institute is looking after nearly 200 orphan chimpanzees. So these are the kind of projects we're doing. And yes, Katrina, you said earlier that I've seen a lot of devastation of the environment and I've seen a lot of suffering, and that's absolutely true, I have. And one of the things that I was finding as I travel 300 days a year is that I was meeting so many young people, a bit older than you, but sort of like first year university, particularly there. And these young people had lost hope. And I'm talking about people all over the world, from China and Africa and Europe, as well as the United States. And a lot of these young people felt angry because they felt that my generation, the one before, the one immediately after, had damaged the environment that was their future. And they were right to be angry because that's exactly what we've done. And some of this anger turned to apathy. Well, let's not worry, we won't bother to do anything because it doesn't make any difference. Or, well, let's have a good time because it's not going to last long, so let's eat, drink, and be merry, tomorrow we die. Or it turned to anger and sometimes to violence. And that was really what's behind the Roots and Shoots program, because Roots and Shoots is indeed a program of hope. And these young people down here are the hope. But it's again a symbolic name. Roots make a firm foundation. Shoots seem tiny, but to reach the sun, they can break through brick walls. And if we see the brick walls as all the problems that we've inflicted on the planet, not only to the environment, to animals, but to each other as well, then you see this is a program of hope, that hundreds and thousands of young people around the world can break through these brick walls that we've created and make the world a better place for the future. So that every group, as you know here very well, tackles three kinds of projects, and they're up along the walls here, to make the world better for animals, people, and the environment. But what some of you may not know is that this program, which began in 1991 with 18 students, is now at least 4,000 active groups across the world in 70 different countries. And a lot of these groups are linked with each other so that when a project is done and is making a difference in one place, you can suddenly realize, wow, there are 600 groups of kids the same age as me, and they're cleaning up rivers, and they're growing forests in their yards, and they're making trails, and they're teaching other younger students about some of these things. So it's my inspiration, and it's my hope, to travel around and see the shining eyes of young people who know that they're making a difference, and to go from place to place to place and meet group after group after group that is making a difference. And of course, the projects that are done will depend on how old the kids are, because we do start in preschool, and we go right through college and university. We've even started, we have Roots and Shoots groups, and I bet you guys don't know this, we have Roots and Shoots groups in prisons, and we have Roots and Shoots groups in old people's homes. And it's all about making the world around you a better place. And the projects you choose will be different whether you're in Africa, China, or North America. They'll be different if you're old or young. They'll be different if you're wealthy or poor. And they'll be different sometimes according to your culture and your religion. But taken all together, it's a vast array of hope for the future. And often kids will ask me, but Dr. Jane, I know you've written a book, Reason for Hope. I know you're always talking about hope, but do you really and honestly have hope, especially after the 11th of September? And some of you know my reasons for hope, and I won't dwell on them. But first of all, the human brain, because 100 years ago, nobody would have believed that we would have people walking on the moon. 100 years ago, we probably find it difficult to convince people about the internet. That would have been science fiction. Even 747s flying up with all those people. I mean, these are magic to me still. You know, I'm in the old world. But we've done all those things, and we've done many more. And sadly, our technology, which has helped so many people, has also led to so much destruction, particularly as our numbers grow. And the two sad things here are the overpopulation in the developing countries, where there is simply more people living on areas of land than the land can support, who are too poor to buy food from elsewhere, and so they suffer. And then the terrible overconsumption of our Western world, which I don't even need to comment on, but you all know what I'm talking about. The overconsumption, where we want so much more than what we need. And it's at the expense of the natural resources of this planet, which are not infinite, after all. And yet, of course, there's hope, because finally we've begun to admit that, yes, there really are environmental problems. And as industry admits that they are indeed causing a lot of damage, so these amazing brains are getting together around the world to find ways of doing things which will enable us to live in better harmony with the world around us, like the different kinds of ways of powering motor vehicles with fuel cells, alternative energy and things like that, with solar power and wind power. And we could talk again a long time about that, but it's encouraging, and it's because people's hearts are becoming involved. And next, the resilience of nature. And we all know places that were destroyed and barren that can be given another chance if we leave them with a lot of time to come back, or if we help them. And the trails I went on today in this school, where the forest is going to come back to an old forest, going through its stages, where there's a place where there's a whole lot of rubble of a wall which was dumped there, which is already beginning to go green, a perfect symbolism for Roots and Shoots, and a whole lot of young people learning how important all these natural processes are and how they're all linked together. But I'm sure many of you know about rivers that were so polluted that the fish no longer bred and the birds were no longer there nesting. Our own River Thames in England was like that. The Potomac that comes out in Washington, D.C. was like a sewer 50 years ago. And 3 years ago, as a result of the cleanup, they started their bass fishing season for the first time in, I don't know, 30 years or so, maybe longer. And it's the same everywhere. Places that were stinking, dirty, spoiled, ugly can be given a second chance. And animals on the very brink of extinction. Well, I carry these symbols with me. And there's one here. I went to Nagasaki, where the second atomic bomb was dropped that ended the Second World War. And I saw the pictures, and it was the same kind of absolute devastation that we're familiar with from Hiroshima. And it was predicted by science that it would take 30 years for the green to come back in Nagasaki. And the green came back fast. It must have been radioactive, but at least it grew. And one little sapling didn't die, and now it's a big tree, it's a shrine. And every spring it puts out new leaves, and that to me is a symbol of hope. And I carry with me a feather from a whooping crane, because 50 years ago there were only 12 whooping cranes left in the world, either captivity or in the wild, 12 individuals. And so most biologists said, well, the whooping crane is virtually extinct. But luckily, one group of biologists decided that they wouldn't let this happen if they could help it. And they started the same kind of program as has more recently been started with the California condor. And because of protection in the wild and captive breeding, there are now 421 whooping cranes in the world, some of them still in breeding programs and others in the wild. So I carry this extremely illegal whooping crane feather with me as a symbol of hope. And the California condor, there were 11 of those birds left, and now there are, I think it's 57, of which there are 4 release sites. And the birds, once again, with this magnificent wingspan, flying over the countryside in California and Arizona. And then, of course, my third reason for hope, after the resilience and forgivingness of nature, are all these young people and all you young people out in the audience there, because there is nothing like the energy and the determination and the commitment of a group of kids like this to give you real hope that indeed the environment and society is going to benefit when they grow up and leave school and move out into the marketplace and get jobs and raise families, because this kind of commitment will not go away. And so especially important here is the kind of motivation that comes from teachers like Katrina Macht. So that's a really, really, for me, important reason for hope, the energy of young people when they know the problems, and we empower them to act. And they're teaching their parents, there's no question about that. And my last reason for hope is what I call the indomitable human spirit. And we all know people who tackle impossible tasks, and they're all around us, and they won't give up. And we all know people who overcome tremendous physical disabilities and lead lives that are truly inspirational to those around them. And it's people like this in all walks of life who are a tremendous source of inspiration and hope for me. I carry with me a little piece of limestone. It comes from the quarries in Robben Island Prison, where Nelson Mandela labored for 17 of his 23 years of imprisonment and emerged with so little bitterness that he could lead his nation out of the evil regime of apartheid without a bloodbath. And we all thought there'd be a bloodbath. Problems in New South Africa, yes, but a great step towards human freedom and dignity. And I don't seem to have this, but I carry with me a surgical glove with the left thumb bent away, because a little boy of 5 who actually lives in New Jersey today got a stick of dynamite that exploded, went off, and damaged both his hands most horribly, and he totally lost his left thumb, and he had to keep going back for corrective surgery. And during these visits to hospital, decided he wanted to become a doctor, which was great, except he wanted to be a surgeon, and people advised him that perhaps that wasn't the best kind of medicine for him to take up with his hands, wonderful as they were very strange shape. but he passed all his medical exams, and he now has a flourishing orthopedic practice in New Jersey and operates on kids who've been damaged in some kind of accidents. And it isn't only humans that give me this feeling of hope for the future. And this is much nearer to home for all of you. This is a boot of one of the rescue dogs who was on ground zero after the 11th of September from day one. And on day two, he cut his foot really badly on a piece of metal or glass, and the veterinarian had to put 9 stitches in. And he told his handler, Police Sergeant Smullen, told him not to let Hansen work for the next few days while his foot began to recover. But Hansen wouldn't eat because Hansen knew there were people who needed him. And so he went back and he was given a boot. He didn't like the boot, he slipped, so he preferred the pain of his bandaged foot. And he's been on the job ever since, and he's still on the job now. And it's this boot I've taken all around the world to talk about the courage of dogs. But beyond that, how much animals can do for us if we accept them as thinking and feeling beings, as real companions, rather than as objects to dominate for our own benefit. And many of you are going to see these wonderful guide dogs, these seeing eye dogs. And again, it just shows this wonderful relationship between humans and animals. A little girl in South Africa came to one of my lectures when she was 13. And she tried to start a roots and shoots group in her school, but she met some resistance. And in the end, she thought, well, I'm not going to wait. I'm going to do something myself. So her parents had as a friend a woman who runs a shelter for stray dogs in Johannesburg in South Africa. And there's a huge stray problem, huge. There's virtually no spaying. So they have to euthanize the dogs about once every 2 weeks. They choose the ones that seem least likely to find homes for and put them to sleep. And that child, she was still not quite 14, when she got it into her head to go to the shelter on the day of the killing of the dogs early so that she could spend at least 10 minutes with each dog and play with it and love it so that it died knowing it was loved. And I don't know where she gets the moral strength to do that. I'm going to meet her in 2 weeks' time. And there is something about children, something about children that is so magical. Like a little girl who came up to me after one of my lectures. She was 5 years old. And she had a little dog in one hand and a little bag of pennies in the other. And her mother said, Amber Mary, I only found out why Amber Mary has been saving up her pocket money 2 days ago. And Amber Mary, and they're not a wealthy family at all, they're very poor actually, but Amber Mary saw one of the documentaries where Flo, the old female chimpanzee Flo, dies and her son Flint dies of grief. I'm sure many of you have seen that Geographic documentary. And Amber Mary knew about grief because her little brother had died of leukemia the year before. And he had loved the chimps in the Busch Garden Zoo. And they'd pushed him in his little wheelchair to see the chimps. And she knew about grief because he had died. But she also knew that we were looking after orphan chimpanzees in Africa who'd lost their mothers. And so could I give the dog to one of those little chimps so that he'd be less lonely at night? And with the pennies, could I buy him some bananas? And the reason I tell that story is because kids get it. And one of the most difficult things for us to realize, knowing that we are one person in a world of 6 billion, is that what we do every day does make a difference, that the little things truly do add up to a lot. And so most people, although they know they should turn the tap off, they shouldn't leave their car engines idling, they should turn off lights, they should pick up trash, all these other small daily things, well, it can't make any difference, can it? It's just me. But you see, if everybody did what they know they should do for the environment and for society every day, can you imagine the difference there'd be? And those of us like probably almost everybody in this room who are lucky enough to be in the wealthier level of society, we have this huge power used collectively to change industry, to improve the environment, to make things better socially, if we make ethical choices in what we buy. Because we don't have to buy products from industry that is not environmentally friendly. We don't have to buy cosmetics tested on animals. We don't have to buy products made with child slave labor or from sweatshops. We don't have to buy those things. And if we don't buy them soon enough, they will not be made, because it is a consumer-driven society. So we have this huge power. And terrorism, well, we've survived terrorism outside the United States for years and years and years. I've been evacuated as a result of bomb scares many times from airports and railway stations. I can remember the Second World War and surviving the bombing. And Mahatma Gandhi said, if you look back through history, every evil has been overcome with good. And just before September the 11th, I was given this little bell and told to ring it for peace. Because this is made from a diffused landmine from the killing fields of Pol Pot, one of the most horrific genocides and mass killings in human history. And now that regime also has come to an end. So those are my reasons for hope. And it's been very wonderful to share those reasons with a group of people like you, with these great kids in this great school, and to know that the blessing that you have with this wonderful land around is being shared with other schools, with kids who are not in such fortunate surroundings, because that is so important, to share what we have. And so I want to thank you all for listening, especially you guys down here on the floor. You must have numb bottoms by now. You'll all be very good at watching chimps and animals, because I've had to sit for hours very still on very hard rocks. It does give you numb bottoms, so you can all jump up and jump around. Anyway, thank you all very much.
Dr. Jane, for all of your words and your message to all of us. And I just want to say to everybody who is here, the Forest Festival is continuing. The booths will be open until 4 o'clock. At 4 o'clock, there will be a little concert. You've had tastes of it from Glenn Waldeck, our traveling minstrel, throughout the day. So at 4 o'clock, we'll have a little concert right here in the gymnasium, and then we'll start our walkathon. Thank you for coming.
Thank you. over here, so I'm going to sit here and watch you guys.
Thank you.